This is Jim Jarrett at the Meisner Technique Acting Studio in San Francisco, and you're listening to 1590 AM, KLIV.
Check here. Hold on.
Check test.
I can hear you, yeah. Are you recording
check, now? Check test. Yeah, I'm trying to. Hold on. All right, is that better?
Yeah.
Sorry?
Yeah, you're fine.
Sorry? Hello? Is that better?
If you'd like to make a call.
Hello? Like my teeth?
Hang up and dial the operator.
Is it done?
It's
is it
still,
going through
it's
a
still
loop?
Playing in my earphones. Did you like that?
Does that go through a loop?
So what do you think of the new show opener? You like that?
Yeah. It's great.
It's pretty psychotic. You know where that came
did
from.
Did I hang up on you?
You did. You don't even remember. You didn't even know that I was recording that day.
No, I didn't.
Yeah.
aren't you actually supposed to say?
Okay, don't hang me on some lame technicality. All right. It's for the sake of the show. All right.
Say hello. Reed.
Hello. The gal sitting over here is.
I'm Ruth.
Hello, Ruthie. Good to see you. My name's Reed. What do we got on task for today? What are we doing today?
Well, first of all, I thought we were going to start off by saying thank you to everyone.
Okay.
Who do you have to thank besides me?
You know what? I'm going to actually kind of pull away and do something out of the ordinary. I think I should probably thank my son, Tegan, and my wife, Wendy, and my stepdaughter, Sierra. And you'd better jump in here because I got a lot of relatives.
Not according to your
thank
book.
Thank you. See, there you go with my book again. Why are you going to bring that up? Which one, by the way? You're talking about?
Chilton Superstar.
All right. Well, that's good. It's getting scripted right now, but this isn't about me. Well, it is all about me, but it's not about the book right now.
Well, I'm Jewish, so I actually do have a huge family.
Okay.
But I'm just going to shout out to my kids, okay. Frankie and Marshall, who probably aren't at home listening.
Sorry. Anybody we're related to does not ever listen.
Right. Including myself.
Including my wife. All right. Well, I've got nobody listens.
I have a note on here that says weather.
Weather?
It's 72 and sunny, isn't it?
We're in San Jose. It's warm out and it's nice. I like that.
Okay. It's paradise. It's always like this.
No. Anyway, enough of that. Go on. Okay.
What's coming up this hour?
Lots of good stuff. Have you heard Natalie Archangel's new one? It's psychotic. I love it. Natalie is on fire today. We've got movies with Greg coming up in a little bit. He's taking on one of my favorite ones. And what's that look for?
No look.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know what that looks about. Okay. We've got The Master. Greg's going to be reviewing The Master, which is, I think, just came out on Friday. And also a classic, Midnight Cowboy. See, there's that look again. Why do you keep giving me this look every time I say Midnight Cowboy?
I really got no look.
All right. You got no look.
I got no look on this one.
You got no look. All right. So check this out. Yes was here. The band Yes.
Owner of a lonely heart.
Anyway, that's Yes?
Yes. Anyway, so Chris was here. Chris Squire was here. And it's funny because I interviewed him, as you know. He sent me out on assignment to go do that.
And see Yes.
I saw Yes. I had a great time.
Yeah.
You know, I saw Yes. I took my son and... it was great. It was, they must've been fumigating in there too, because it had the strangest odor in the whole place.
Did it smell like an opium tent?
It did. I thought it was memories of Grateful Dead all over again.
Growing up.
Oh God, here we go.
We used to.
James, cue the violins. We're kidding. Thanks for
my next door neighbor. Lori.
Moving on.
We used to be up in her room like we were in high school and her, you know, doing what you do in high school. And my friend's mother would open up the door and she'd go, "It smells like an opium den in here."
Okay. All right, moving on. We had Chris Squire on phone. He's the founder, one of the founders of Yes. He's the bass player. He's been with the band 44 years, the only member of Yes that has been on every single Yes album over their prolific four decades in rock and roll. And I had the unique distinction of being able to speak with Chris. It is a phone interview, so please bear with us. A little bit dodgy connection. I think he called in on a cell phone, which is a no-no. And then your favorite and my favorite as well, we have Javier. Javier IDEAMI is going to be here. Javier IDEAMI will be here, and he's going to be talking about singing. He's going to be telling people the most important thing you must know, my friends, in order to sing. It'll be wonderful. And then we have a special series kicking off over until the end of the year. We have Jim Jarrett.
Oh,
yeah,
cool.
Jim Jarrett is graciously allowed me to go to his studio and interview him. Jim Jarrett, of course, the Sanford Meisner's last teaching student, protege, I should say, and going to be doing a multi-part installment with Jim, asking him everything from, well, I don't want to let the cat out of the bag, but today's interview highlight is phenomenal. He talks about 9/11. And as we know, 9/11 just happened, the anniversary of it. And then we've got David Watts. I am so, so, so jazzed about David Watts. He is man on fire. David Watts is just beat. You're going to mad if I say beat poetry, but he's my generation. We're both in our pushing our looking at. We're staring at 50. Me and David are staring at 50.
Wait a second.
Just stop.
I'm older than you. I don't feel like I'm staring at 50.
I was staring at 50 when I was 20. All right. That's how I roll. Okay.
All right.
I roll in just worst case scenario on everything. But case in point is that David Watts, some call him slam poet, some call him beat poet. David Watts is a man that I can relate to, and the guy has got power in his voice and a really compelling message too. So, and then we're gonna go unscripted, and that's about how.
Are you yawning? Are you serious?
What's it to you? If I'm
Did
yawning?
You just yawn?
I'm yawning. On... All right.
Are you tired?
I'm very tired.
Why?
Well, I'm not making enough for one. But, who would I take that up with? Oh, wait a minute. You own the show.
Take that up with your executive producer. Yeah,
I think that's you. Mm. Yes, I am tired. I'm very tired.
Put your request in writing.
Sorry. All requests must be submitted in writing. Thank you for coming.
Is that how I sound?
It's
a little?
A little bit. Is that how I sound?
Wait till Jeff. Oh, then we have what's his face is going to be here, too. Jeff, I think we're going to be recording with Jeff. Applebaum.
Jeff Applebaum.
The brother of Johnny Appleseed, Jeff Appleseed, will be here. Anyway, no, Jeff Applebaum.
I thought he was the owner of Applebee's.
No, that's Applebaum's.
Applebaum's.
Applebaum's. You know, Applebaum's neighborhood falafel and shuffleboard court.
I think you have been up too long.
I am.
You're getting punchy.
I got 2 hours sleep last night. I'm very tired. So,
should we go to commercial?
All right, we'll be back after this message.
The Offspring. October 2nd, the newly renovated San Jose Civic, performing all their hits. The Offspring, with special guests, Neon Trees, and Dead Sarah. Tickets are on sale now at Ticketmaster.com. New album, Days Go By, available now. The Offspring, October 2nd, the San Jose Civic.
I'm Melissa Erdman, Arts and Entertainment Calendar Editor. You're listening to Reed Martin Basso Upstage on 1590 KLIV, NBC's Silicon Valley News Station.
Why only 2 hours of sleep?
Because I was working on the show, and I've got another something I'm working on, too. So
what else are you working on?
I mean, don't make me say it.
No, I have to make you say it. It's a radio. What are you going to say?
Because you're going to think that I'm a freaking weirdo if I say it. And I just don't. It's just something very personal to me. I've got my own agenda, my own campaign going on, and that's where I'm at.
So, Reed?
Yeah.
Yeah, I already think you're weird, so go ahead. Knock it out, babe.
All right. So let me just put this out there. So I am equally disenfranchised. We don't talk politics or anything like that on the show. So I'm not going to talk politics. I'm just going to simply say that I have a major announcement coming up that impacts 100% of the people in my household. And, and it could actually have, and I'm serious, it could actually have global consequences. Or not consequences. No, that's not the right word. Have global reach. There you go. Global reach. And if it comes to fruition, if it actually happens.
So all right.
I'm pretty jazzed about that.
What is that?
I'm going to actually, I'm not going to tell anybody, but I'm actually going to be announcing my candidacy, my write-in candidacy for president. Mm-hmm. I'm announcing. I'm going to go ahead and do it now. All right. Funny you should ask. I am announcing. Okay. Are you rolling your eyes? All right.
Just a little.
All right. All right. I'm going to announce my write-in candidacy for presidency. So I'm not running with a running mate. I'm just running with myself.
So, as usual.
And one of my books. So I'll be.
Okay.
So and right, my iPod.
So I'm going to pretend to take this seriously for a minute.
No, wait.
I want to hear what your platform is.
My what?
Your platform. Do you have a platform?
Ooh. I have a platform. Yes, my platform. I have a platform. Here's my running platform. I have no interest in Pinterest. How's that? You like that?
That's some platform.
It's.
Have you ever even been on Pinterest?
No, I've not done that, but I have no interest in it. Everybody's like Pinterest. I don't know what it is. It's of no interest to me. My life has gone fine, and I don't need Pinterest. So,
I can pull it up on my thingy, and you can check it out.
I've never seen it.
Do you want to see it?
How can I run on a platform if I've never? Wait a minute. I'm making your point. Wait a minute. Okay, I need to run on the platform. I have no interest in vote for me. I have no running mate. I have no political agenda. Write me in. And I have no interest in Pinterest, and that's my, for 4 years, it'll be that.
Will you be listed as me on the ballot?
It'll be Reed Martin Basso, or R. Martin Basso, since I can't seem to shake that that old moniker. So, what is that you have there? What are you doing with your laptop? What is that? What are you doing? What are you pulling up?
I'm going to pull up Pinterest
for you.
I have a Pinterest account.
You did, really? Let me see it.
I don't use it, but...
Oh, let me see it. See? You have no interest. You have no interest. See, I already got a vote, all right? All right, so let me see this. You got it. You have one. I have one.
I'm going to pull it up for you.
All right. Well, let me see it. Let me see this Pinterest thing. Is it Pinterest? Pinterest.
Let me pull it up.
No interest in Pinterest. All right. Ooh, wait a minute. You don't. Yeah. Okay. Hold on. Wait. Move your fingers. All right. I can't see the. Stop pointing at the. What? Okay. Huh.
Should we go to commercial and I'll show you?
Huh. That's pretty cool. Huh.
Read.
What?
What are you doing?
I'm taking an interest in Pinterest. I have to change my marketing. All right, we'll be back after this message. Thanks for messing up my campaign strategy.
Memphis, presented by Broadway San Jose, October 23rd through the 28th. Buy online at BroadwaySanJose.com or call 408-792-4111.
Hi, this is Aaron Levinman, playwright and arts activist. You're listening to 1590 AM KLIV Silicon Valley News.
We're back.
Oh, my bad. Sorry. Okay. All right. Hey, and we're back. Hello, San Jose. Okay, we're back. San Jose Bay Area. This is Reed Martin Basso, and this is Ruth Pangolinan sitting over here to the right of me.
Well done.
Pangolinan,
you had it right the first time. Stop thinking about it.
I know I did. It's just been me messing with you for 22 years. 4 years on how to say your last name.
Uh-huh.
Sorry, I was a little bit distracted. This Pinterest thing is really freaking cool. So great. I get to change my.
You could always withdraw your nomination your desire to run.
No, the desire is there. It's just I need to come up with a platform now, and I'll come up with something.
Which came first, the platform or the candidate?
Moving on.
Right.
Okay, we're not supposed to be talking politics. Politics and all this.
Hi, this is Natalie Archangel with Natalie's Nebulous Nihilism. So I'm watching YouTube the other night, and I stumble across a video of Miss Peggy Lee singing Fever from what looks to be a TV variety show from the early 60s. Now she's sublime. Red evening gown, blonde hair pulled back off her face and falling gently onto her shoulders. Fever in the morning, fever all through the night. And suddenly, out of stage left, comes this guy dancing across the stage. And by today's standards, he looks absurd, ridiculous, gawky, like a young colt. But not in a good way.
What?
How can I, somebody who can't pick up choreography with a pitchfork, be so judgmental? When you kiss me. Without even thinking about it. When you kiss me. Well, the answer is easy. I'm now trained to the standards of today. By today's standards, anyone who can't come in and do top-level gymnastics with their dancing is useless. A non-dancer. In fact, we're all trained that way. People who wouldn't make the grade on the first cut of any of these dancing shows of today were the professional dancers of 50 years ago. Fever. Makes me wonder, with the standards so high, what's it doing to America's youth? Are they turning off the TV in disgust? Becoming depressed and drinking their 64-ounce Slurpees and becoming more obese? Huh. Let's fight childhood obesity by turning off the TV for all the right reasons. The standards are too high. For Natalie's Nebulous Nihilism, this is Natalie.
Are we lowering our expectations then?
Was that the best? Oh my God. The standards are too high. Isn't that great?
Yeah, she's fantastic.
She is.
I love it.
I love her. She's got some other stuff she did that's it's coming up tomorrow on Thursday that's going to knock your socks off. I'm in a great...
You mean Tuesday?
What did I say? Thursday? Today's Thursday. Did you know today's Thursday?
I did, but you haven't slept in a while. Today,
so. Yes, I know. I know. I'm still working on my campaign, my new campaign stroke slogan there. All right. So are we going to do a calendar right now? What are we going to do right now?
We could do a calendar.
Go ahead and do it. Let's jump into the calendar. See what we got going on.
Let's see what's coming up.
Okay.
Well, you caught me off guard with this.
Is that
whole,
actually
like,
paper?
Yes, I know. I'm using paper.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Since you're not using your laptop, let me have that. I just want to check.
Do you want?
I just want to check here. Let me see. How do you?
I wish. You know what? I wish it was actually in a better format. I might have to get on my laptop.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
It's actually not called a laptop. It's an iPad.
It's an iPad. You got that for free too. So.
I have nice friends.
Yeah. You know,
it was
nice,
a gift.
Nice in your friends. It's my show. How come you're the one getting the gifts? What are you doing?
I think I just gifted you a show.
I think I stand corrected. I stand corrected. Thank you for...
I gifted you a microphone and potentially somebody who might be listening out there.
Not my wife. I know that. She doesn't listen to anything I do.
I'm not listening either. Did you want this piece of paper?
The big question is, will Ruth even tune in to listen to her own show? What am I doing with this?
I don't know. You wanted the calendar.
All right. Coming up, Crosby, Stills, and Nash. Wait a minute. No, they're not. We just had the San Jose Civic. I was just...
Hey, Reid, have you heard about the new San Jose Civic?
Oh, in my best broadcast announcer voice, I shall reply, yes, I have. Here's a quick shout out to the San Jose Civic in recognition of their exciting new design changes. Hosting a variety of entertainment events, the historic San Jose Civic invites you to experience the difference at their newly remodeled venue. New seats, new lighting, new sound, and so much more, it's only the beginning. Come rediscover the historic San Jose Civic and prepare to be impressed by San Jose Civic's state-of-the-art $15 million renovation. For over 76 years, the San Jose Civic has presented numerous entertainment legends, including the Rolling Stones, Frank Sinatra, Yes, The Who, Santana, Kiss, Fats Domino, The Beach Boys, Barbra Streisand, Crosby, Stills, and Nash, rock legends, international superstars, family shows, and more. If it's entertainment, chances are that it's headed to the newly remodeled San Jose Civic to become part of showbiz history. A legacy of entertainment, 7 decades in the making and still going strong, continues at the San Jose Civic as the San Jose Civic rededicates itself to providing our beautiful San Jose Bay Area with great live entertainment. So come on down and experience the difference of the newly renovated San Jose Civic, 135 West San Carlos Street in historic downtown San Jose, California. Tickets for all San Jose Civic shows are always available at Ticketmaster.com or by calling 408-792-4111. Be sure to visit sanjose.com for up-to-date information, and don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. The beautifully remodeled and always historic San Jose Civic. Experience the difference today. Does that meet your approval?
Yes, sir.
Snow Patrol, live in concert. Just say yes. Just say this. October 21st, newly renovated San Jose Civic. Snow Patrol, Fallen Empires, available now. Don't wait. Get your tickets on sale right now. Tickets available at Ticketmaster. Go to snowpatrol.com for more. Another Niederlander concert.
Hey, we've got Greg Kleinschmidt. While you're clearly looking for the
calendar?
For the calendar. Let's go ahead and check out Greg's thing. He's doing this thing on the review on the master. He's actually made me want to check this out too.
So. Okay.
All right.
Make it happen.
All right.
Hi, I'm Greg Kleinschmidt, and this is Movies with Greg. Tonight, I'll be talking about the highly anticipated new film, The Master, from writer-director Paul Thomas Anderson. Behind some of the best-loved and critically acclaimed films of the past 15 years, which include Boogie Nights, Magnolia, Punch Drunk Love, and There Will Be Blood, his latest opus, The Master, is an intensely focused and intimate character study. It stars Joaquin Phoenix as a disillusioned naval veteran, and Philip Seymour Hoffman as the persuasive leader of a cult who takes Phoenix under his wing and attempts to mold him. In what will undoubtedly be the finest performance of any actor this year, Phoenix completely transforms himself into his character and displays acting chops belonging to the greats. The two leads emanate off the screen, and Anderson lets his camera linger on them. Somewhat similar in tone to his last film, There Will Be Blood, The Master is a challenging, slow burn of a film. I was lucky enough to catch an early screening with Anderson in attendance himself, and it proved to be an unforgettable experience. Once again, he has made a staggering, monumental work of art. The movie opens in a limited release September 21st. That's Movies with Greg. I'm Greg Kleinschmidt.
I'm Melissa Erdman, Arts and Entertainment Calendar Editor. If you have a San Jose Bay Area arts and entertainment event you'd like showcased in the calendar, call me at 408-792-4517 or email info@broadwaysanjose.com.
Okay, so...
Right. That was pretty awesome. Greg's a man. Love it. He's got another one he's doing. He's going to be reviewing in a little while.
Yeah.
It's Midnight Cowboy.
Yeah, it's an awesome movie.
1969 Academy Award winner with Dustin Hoffman and John Boyd. That's Angelina Jolie's dad, by the way. I didn't know if you knew that.
I actually did. Yeah. I am in the business.
I think that I am in the business. You are in the business of owning people like me.
Right. I own Angelina Jolie.
Do you really?
No.
Angelina Jolie could buy and sell you, trade you with food stamps.
I wish.
All right. Hey, okay. Good job to Greg. And we're going to have Greg coming back in the second hour, in the second half of this hour doing Midnight Cowboy. What you got for events calendar?
So events calendar, here's what's coming up at the San Jose Center for Performing Arts.
My old stomping ground when I used to perform. Go on. What do you got?
Okay. So on Saturday the 22nd,
yes,
we have the C.S. Lewis's Screw Tape Letters.
Oh, hey.
We're going to interview that guy.
We'll
have more on that interview on the 20th.
You mean Max?
Max McClain.
Yeah, Max McClain. We're gonna be interviewing him later today, I think, for broadcast later, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
That'll be for broadcast later. Okay, cool.
He's the playwright and the plays in the starring role.
Yeah, that's pretty sick. I think that's pretty
Are you familiar with that story?
Yeah, actually I am. It's from C.S. Lewis. It's pretty sweet. Oh. So let's talk to him about it when he gets to.
And then also at the Center for Performing Arts coming up in October.
Drum roll.
Yay! Is Broadway San Jose is presenting.
Well,
wait, why are you doing that?
It's a drum roll.
People don't want to hear that.
That was a drum roll.
But that's a drum roll?
All right.
That sounded like you pounding on the mic.
All right, moving on. Moving on.
October 23rd through the 28th at the San Jose Center for Performing Arts is the Tony Award-winning Broadway musical, Memphis.
What's the connection to the Bay Area, real quick?
The connection is this show actually world premiered at Theater Works.
It did.
In Mountain View.
Yep, and then it went to Broadway.
Yeah, so Theater Works does this New Works Festival every year. Usually takes place in August. And they go out and they get new plays, new musicals, and they read them and perform them, sort of staged readings in front of a live audience and get feedback. Memphis was part of that New Works Festival and then went from the New Works Festival.
Got picked up and went to Broadway.
And it went to their stage.
Isn't that fat?
And then it got picked up for a pre-Broadway run in San Diego and Seattle. Then it went to Broadway and won the Tony Award for the Best Musical.
Well, it's phenomenal. I've seen it twice. It's an amazing show. I'm going to be there. You and I are doing...
we'll be there opening night.
And closing. Well, we're doing...
I'll be there every night.
You're there every night. I'm contracted opening Wednesday and closing Sunday. For both
opening
shows.
Tuesday.
Oh, I'm sorry. Strike that. Okay. Out of the six shows, I do three. So
eight shows?
I do eight.
We do eight. You do how many?
I do 16 shows. I am actively looking for a new agent. If anybody out there would like to save me, I'm sorry, represent me. Is it normal? Is it normal to take 72% of what I make?
It is for me.
I know it is. All right. Moving on.
So that's in October. And then in November, we're presenting Kathy Rigby as Peter Pan.
That's going to be sweet. I've seen the commercials. Yeah, those are looking nice. Hey, I know who's doing your voiceover on that? Let's give him a plug real quick.
Oh, right. Cause it's all
Kathy
about you.
Kathy Rigby is Peter Pan.
That's your Thanksgiving.
I thought you said that's what
that's November 20th through the 25th.
Ooh, that's going to be, that'll be, okay, cool. I'm not going out of town this year.
And then you know who's going to be at, in October? George Lopez.
George Lopez, and hopefully we can get him in studio too.
And then Offspring, Snow Patrol.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And then the Belly Dance Superstars.
Okay.
I think that sounds cool.
That is actually cool. I've never seen that, but I know what belly dancing is. and I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, I think I'm going to see if I can try to score some tickets.
It's okay. Good.
That's at the Civic also. Well,
let's go check that out.
Yeah.
I actually do want to see it because it's going to be like a cultural festival too. So it'll be awesome.
It'll be very cool.
Sweet. Sweet.
So what did we say we had?
So moving on to, what else do you have on the calendar? Do you have anything else on the calendar? Or do you want to call it wraps on that?
Let's call it wraps on the calendar. You want
to call it wraps on the calendar?
Because cool. I can't actually see this print.
Javier!
Idiomi!
Idiomi! Okay.
Wait, what do you say? Wait. Is it Javier Idiomi?
I don't know.
No, it's not.
The first time I heard it, I swear to God, I thought it was Ademi, right? Which is how I pronounce it.
Ademi?
I know. Ademi. He's actually, you know what? I yank his chain a lot, but you know what? I did a film, one of his films last year. He just came back from Spain. But anyway, blah, 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 blah. But he and his wife have she's a phenomenal cook, by the way. She did the same thing. She pronounces it the way he does, Idiomi. And I was like, stop, slow down. I say Ademi. But anyway.
Javier.
The first time I heard it, I thought she was saying my name is Idi Amin.
Wait, Reed. It's Javier Idi Amin.
Idi Amin. It's Idea Me, M I.
But it's Idi Amin.
That's how he says it. I say Ademi.
Right, let's listen to it.
All right.
I am Javier Idi Amin, and this is the Creative Minute. All right, so you say you cannot sing. Oh, okay, but you like opera and things like that? You know, in the opera, singers are using their diaphragm. They are breathing from deep within. That's how they produce such powerful sound. Well, you can start to do that right now. Lie down on your bed, in horizontal, relaxed. Start to focus around your stomach, where the diaphragm is. And let the air go deep within and look how it races up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. Well, that's already the beginning. Up and down, in the right direction. If you are able to do that, up and down, you are already on the right track to a powerful singing that one day may reach what those professionals are doing. Up and down. So, diaphragm, deep breathing. Remember, that's the secret for great singing. This was the Creative Minute. I'm Javier Idiomi.
I told you.
I love
him. There isn't he the best? He is the coolest guy on the planet. And where do you meet him? I mean, he's an internationalist. He lives 6 months of the year. He's got a place in San Francisco, he and his wife. And then they go to, I think they just got back from Barcelona for, they were rapping on post-production on The Weight of Light, which is his last film. He's going into production on another film. And that's the one that I was in. And then
which one were you in?
The Weight of Light. I was a guy standing in line. But anyway, so check this out. But IMDb
credit for that?
Yes, actually.
Guy standing in line.
Guy. Okay.
Do you have any?
I was actually lead protester. come on.
Sorry.
Okay.
My bad.
Yes.
I'm zipping my lip, even on radio.
All right. Anyway.
Okay.
Okay. Wait. We talked about Jim Jarrett, right?
Right. You told me a little bit about him.
Okay.
Meisner.
Yes.
Meisner Studio he runs that. Were you a student of his?
No. Was I?
Yeah.
Of whose?
Jim's.
No, I wasn't.
Oh, okay.
We have a mutual friend who just came out of James Franco's movie, Cherry. That was shot in San Francisco. She is one of James's students, and
Jarrett or James Franco.
I'm sorry, there's too many J's in this.
Jim Jarrett.
Jim Jarrett.
Okay.
Yeah, at the Meisner Studio, Meisner Technique Studio in San Francisco.
Can you explain the Meisner Technique to me?
I would rather have Jim explain it.
This is Jim Jarrett at the Meisner Technique Acting Studio in San Francisco, and you're listening to 1590 AM KLIV.
Before icons can ascend to the status of legends, they must touch their discipline in such a way that long after an icon's passing, all that remains is a new standard by which perfection is defined. Just as classic icons like Beethoven and Shakespeare each set the respective standards of music and literature, contemporary titans, likewise, set standards for future generations as well. Popular culture will forever be gauged in 15-minute increments of fame by 20th century's pop art icon Warhol. Dance will forever be standardized to the movements and timing of Fred Astaire. And in the world of stage and moving image performance, the late Sanford Meisner will continue to define acting methodology. Sanford Meisner died on February 2nd, 1997, having created a legacy of theater and film teachings in his 91 years of life. Only a select handful of emerging talents were personally selected by Sanford Meisner to teach the Meisner acting technique. Amongst those few selected, as one of Meisner's protégés, film and stage actor Jim Jarrett holds the unique distinction of having been Sanford Meisner's last protégé. Jim Jarrett has been teaching the Meisner technique throughout the world since Sanford Meisner's death in 1997. Jim Jarrett spent 25 years building the Meisner Technique Studios in Idaho, Hawaii, and Florence, Italy. Last year, after a quarter century of rotating the teachings equally each year, Jim Jarrett finally came home to the San Jose Bay Area, where he opened his now-renowned Meisner Technique Acting Studio in the scenic and picturesque San Francisco Presidio. Recently, Jim and I sat down for an interview.
Jim, 9/11. Where were you? What? Tell me your...
I was in Ohio, headed to Columbus to do Meisner. The bus has a satellite, but you have to pull over to do it, so we pulled over to get some gas and did that and watched it unfold and heard people talking and obviously the horrific experience, just shocking, and we're supposed to load in a show and do a show that night. And we called the presenter, and she said, let's do it anyway. We showed up. Four people came to a 300-seat theater.
Wow.
So there was that. And I was still out on tour for the next several months. It was a surreal experience to be driving all over the United States, not flying, but driving. Mm-hmm. So your foot's on the ground, and for everyone involved, you can really feel it. In terms of the world of touring, everything changed that day. It was noticeable within, I'd say, 6 months, because there was so much uncertainty, the economics that were affected by that, so many lives and the ripple effect of that, and audiences. Just for a myriad of reasons, the fallout economically in the world of performing arts, the funding for performing arts, the economy, the economics behind it. I just saw a huge shift happen in terms of our job as touring artists and the opportunities available. And it continued even before the big quote-unquote economic, whatever you want to call it, of the last 3 or 4 or 5 years, whatever it's been now. Prior to that, it was happening. And like I said, it happened, started after 9/11. Things just shifted. And performing art venues, the donors, the corporate donors, the money that used to come into a performing arts venue. I'm not talking about, corporate giving. I'm talking about just, those nice, lovely base that all theaters must have. It shifted dramatically, and it's affected all of us.
What do you think audiences want now, in 2012, going into 2015?
Well, that's a very broad question. What do they want? They want value for the dollar. That's the easiest answer, whether it's music, dance, theater. I think that they want to be inspired and led. There's a lot of fear out there, and understandably. I think that, that our job as artists is never more important. If you have a voice on this planet, you're more needed and more important than ever before. Whether as an actor through your films or your writing or your actual just literal work as an actor, to work on parts that say something, that stand for something, that can hold a mirror up for people, that can help them through this uncertain times, etc. It's a great honor, and more needed and more important than ever before. The storytellers, the people that can help a society transition, and we absolutely are going through one. So I think that's what audiences want. They want to be, and of course, there's just the, they just want to be entertained as well. Just check out, turn it off, leave the pressures of their everyday life. So I get that as well. I'm not that guy. My work is not about that. I know that it serves a beautiful role, that simple just escapism, whether it's a film or a theater piece. But I want to rock you. I want to shake you. I want to inspire you. And So I feel like the role of what we do is more needed than ever before right now.
How important is the venue? Can you perform under a tree? Does it have to be Carnegie Hall?
Wow, that's a great question. Both. It depends on the product.
The place that we've both been to is a Civic. Civic Center in San Jose. Yeah.
Now, I haven't been back in a long time, and I've heard that there have been some beautiful, beautiful, wonderful changes, so I need to get back down there. So, but the last time I was there, I had a beautiful experience. I walk into a theater, and it's my office, and I love it. In all these years of touring, you know, when we were in London a couple of years ago, I had a three-week tour. I did 15 shows in 21 days, 15 different venues in 21 days, so it was a barnstormer. And I'm telling you, I was in some little theaters that had 150 seats, and the next night, 1,000 seater. All of them have their own personality. Some are more intimate, and I'm talking about 1,000 seaters that are intimate. It just depends on the venue. I like a venue that has soul, that has a, and you can have a brand new theater, by the way, that has soul. It all starts at the top. It's the way it's run. It's the way the guests, the audience members are treated. There's the basics in terms of just quality sound and lighting, etc., and comfortable seats. Those would be nice, but you know, I'm sure we both have sat in horrible wooden chairs, but what was in front of us was so magical. So it's the product.
So for the actor, the venue is irrelevant. I would submit that for the actor, the venue is irrelevant.
Trust me, I have performed in some venues where, they are state-of-the-art, beautiful houses. And an honor to set foot on the stage. But the front of house, the people that quote-unquote run the place, you're like, you've been invited as a guest to come into a house, and yet you're treated horribly. So that taints it. I guess it just depends. Some shows require more technical support, professional technical support. We did our Vincent show in Hawaii a few years ago for this coalition against drug abuse and meth and ice that's unfortunately epidemic in this one area, and did a benefit. It was outdoors under a tin roof. It started to rain. I had to stop the show for 10 minutes because it rained so hard you couldn't hear. I had to scream. You couldn't. We had two lights. Our show needs a minimum of 15. We had two. And when it was all said and done, the 250 people that were sitting there, myself included, had a beautiful evening. And yet our show, the look of the show and the feel of the show would benefit greatly from being in a more technically sophisticated experience. So, look, it just depends. I think that the audience, they love coming to a theater and a venue that has a charm to it.
Do you have any closing thoughts?
I do. I think that I touched on it briefly before, but in closing, I just would like to say that the importance of the arts, and especially for our children, is more important than ever before because of all the budget cuts, because of all of the things going on in the economy. Families aren't able to afford to take their children to go to experience these things. And I guess I just would like to be a partner in coming up with a solution. You know, I'm currently working with our children's shows, and I've been asked, well, why don't you just bring them to the schools? It'll be so much cheaper that way. You don't have to bus the kids in, etc. I get it, but it's not what I want. I want them to come to the theater. I want them to come to a real professional house. I want them to get on a bus. I want them to walk upstairs. I want them to come into those seats and go, wow, and have this experience that maybe for one kid in there literally changes their life forever because of that day and that magic that can happen in that room. So in closing, what you have down in San Jose and all the diverse, wonderful communities there that are just thriving and growing, and to be able to have them step forward and be voices and have access to the theater as well and provide those opportunities. And I just, whatever can be done to help bridge the gap more and more in these tough economic times so that people can be inspired by quality entertainment, I'm a fan of.
Jim, this has been an absolute privilege. Thank you.
Thank you as well. It's my pleasure.
Catch more of Jim Jarrett's interview and upcoming editions of Reed Martin Basso Upstage, right here on 1590 AM, KLIV.
Broadway San Jose presents their 2012-2013 season with Memphis,
Kathy Rigby as Peter Pan. Rock of Ages. Blue Man Group. Billy Elliot the Musical. And Green Day's American Idiot. Visit BroadwaySanJose.com or call 408-792-4111.
Snow Patrol, live in concert. Just say yes. Just say there's no October 21st, newly renovated San Jose Civic. Snow Patrol, Fallen Empires, available now. Don't wait. Get your tickets on sale right now. Tickets available at Ticketmaster. Go to snowpatrol.com for more. Another Niederlander concert.
Okay, cool. Nice. All right. Snow Patrol. Yay. They're going to be here at the San Jose Civic. I'm going to take my son to it. He'll like it, or he won't. I know that I will.
Is he a fan?
I don't know. I don't know if he is. I know that I think they're pretty sweet. Curious name, but, you know. I think
my son likes them.
Does he? Marshall?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, we don't have really any music by them, but, you know.
He knows of them.
He knows of them.
The one my son is really looking forward to is Offspring.
Offspring, yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah. We used to play Crazy Taxi. In fact, that is, like, the best game ever made. And I think it's, like, a Sega system or something like that. Anyway, yeah, 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 yeah. Anyway, enough of that. Hey, so check this out. I want to get to, I've actually been sort of chomping at the bit on this. Greg, Movies with Greg, he's doing one of my top five all-time favorite movies of all time. Do you have his spot?
Yeah. Midnight Cowboy?
Midnight Cowboy. Mm-hmm. 1969 Academy Award winner with John Voight and Dustin Hoffman, breakthrough film for both of them. Mm-hmm. And Greg's going to go ahead and take it on. Go ahead. Do you have it? Go ahead and take it away.
Okay. Wait, just before you hear this.
Yep. go ahead. Just hit play.
Well, just before you hear it, there was a look I was giving you earlier, and I just...
I'm on 2 hours sleep. You're going to make me go back to the beginning of the show. All right.
Okay. Go ahead and play it.
All right. Well, hit play. You've got the button over there. Hit play.
Okay.
All right.
Hi, I'm Greg Kleinschmidt, and this is Classic Movies with Greg.
Miami Beach, that's where you could score. Anybody can score, Dave, and you.
Tonight I'll be discussing John Schlesinger's 1969 classic, Midnight Cowboy.
In New York, no rich lady with any class at all buys that cowboy crap anymore. They're laughing at you on the street.
Starring John Voight and Dustin Hoffman, Midnight Cowboy became the first X-rated movie to win an Oscar for Best Picture.
Oh, what the hell do you know about women anyway? When's the last time you scored, boy?
The story follows a naive hustler, played by Voight, and his close relationship with a seedy cripple, played by Hoffman, as they try to make their way into Nixon-era New York City. One of the most heartbreakingly intimate character studies ever made.
And I'll tell you another thing. Frankly, you're beginning to smell.
Midnight Cowboy holds up strongly over time.
And for a stud in New York, that's a handicap.
It works as a great snapshot of a long-lost era and as a showcase for two great actors on top of their game. A good portion of the dialogue was improvised during extensive pre-production rehearsals, and this gives the film the spark of authenticity.
I bet you ain't never even been late. How about that?
I know enough to know that great big dumb cowboy crap of yours don't appeal to nobody except every Jackie on 42nd Street. That's stuff. You want to call by its name, that's strictly for f***ing.
Both actors completely own their roles, that there's never a thought given to them being actors. They just are these characters. Midnight Cowboy is a film that could move me to tears, and it does, time and again. It also possesses one of the best soundtracks of all time, even if it is minimal. John Barry's longing theme, contrasted with Harry Nilsson's Everybody's Talking, helps elevate the film to legendary status. That's Classic Movies with Greg. I'm Greg Kleinschmidt.
What in the... Really?
Look, you know...
What are you doing? Oh, my God. Are you kidding me? I put that together. Do you know how long I worked on that?
Yeah.
All right. Greg delivered it. It's awesome. You beeped my trailer. My spot. What are you doing? Thanks.
I had to.
Why? Wait a minute. No. None of George Carlin's seven deadly words were in there. Okay. Why? Okay. Now
sometimes, but you know what? Sometimes those seven deadly or seven words that you're not supposed to say, they change.
Okay. It's not okay. Well, I didn't get the memo on that. Okay. Firstly, it's an Academy Award winning film, won Best Picture. It is a soundbite directly from the film. It is
you know, it is improv. He says it right there. Greg says it right there in his own review. It was improv.
Look, I told you when I first
that was the the majesty of that movie was their improv dialogue back and forth, and you just bleeped it when he reviewed one of my favorite movies.
Well, I told you when I first heard it that I wasn't sure if it was going to fly, and it's not going to fly. So, people actually find that word. They would call it the new F word, I think.
I find it offensive, too, but it's not about being offensive or not offensive. It is
maybe the movie is not about being offensive or not offensive, but the show is not about being offensive.
Okay, that's a good point. You make a good point. And we're not looking to polarize or galvanize or any of those other eyes that are out there, you know, freak out eyes or anything like that.
Betty Davis eyes.
Betty Davis eyes. You know, brown eyes girl. All right. Anyway. No, seriously. So, all right. So what you're saying here, for the sake of argument, is that we have a new F word.
I am actually saying that. I'm not saying it for the sake of argument. I think it actually exists.
Personally, I do too. But, I mean, I object to it being taken out, having a political message being brought into something that is not intended to be anything other than a showcase for one of the best movies ever made.
I don't think it's a political message. And I think to call it a political message is overstating it. It's an offensive word. And
it is an offensive word.
And, you know, people take offense to it. And we don't need to perpetuate it anymore. We don't need to actually give permission to say it just because it happened to be in an Academy Award winning film. That shouldn't give us permission to perpetuate the use of that word through, you know, again, yet again.
Well, then it's sort of going in. You know what? It was interesting. This conversation is sort of going into the Ted Turner colorizing old black and white movies area.
How so?
Well, you know, are we going to go through all films and start sanitizing films? Or are we going to start going through all black and white films and start giving them color? You know, it's
an
interesting question.
I think we gave people enough of a soundbite about the film and enough of a review that they can now make the decision themselves. To watch it in an appropriate way with people who can handle it.
That is, you know, that's very poignant. All right, fine. And well taken.
By the way, a fantastic film.
It is an amazing film. You know who always has an opinion?
You?
No, David Watts. David Watts has an opinion.
Let's hear David Watts' opinion.
David Watts.
Is it on Midnight Cowboy or something else?
It's on David Watts. David Watts is giving us his opinion on David Watts, and that is, you couldn't ask for a whole lot more. Do you have the sound? I don't like to usually go two clips or two features back to back, but do you have David's stuff over there?
I do.
All right.
Shall I push a button?
Take it away.
Or ask James to?
Put James, please, push your buttons.
My name is David Watts, and this is The Way Things Are. When you think of marketing, what comes to mind? For me, it's a room filled with executives all poring over one pitch, trying to find the right delivery and the right way to position their client's product so it'll be received by a grateful and waiting public. Millions, if not billions, are spent on television advertising, billboards, and other ideas that will get that product into the consciousness of the consumer. But that was yesterday. Today, all it takes is a tweet by a well-known actress to get that product into a stellar orbit or a well-liked Facebook page. Indeed, some of the most successful marketing agencies don't even have a storefront. They're run from the garage of some very enterprising entrepreneurs who just happen to have a group of followers willing to promote any brand they're willing to speak of. This is a new economy and a new day. We better adapt to it or get left in the dust. I'm David Watts, and this is just the way things are.
So how sweet was that?
It was nice, yeah.
David Watts is the man. David, thank you. Going to have to give him a shout-out. David Watts is definitely on fire, man, on fire right there. Love him. Love him. He's going to be back next week with some really insightful stuff, too. He's going to drop some beats next week, too. It's going to be really deep, man. Going to go all Coltrane on us.
Okay, Reed.
Actually, no, he's doing Marvin Gaye. He's going to do a classic review on Marvin Gaye and Marvin Gaye's influence on
him. Okay. Hey, Reed, I'm going to have to interrupt here.
On culture.
I know.
You're interrupting Reed. My ADHD rant.
What? That's because we're out of time. And we're actually going to have to
yes. We haven't gotten to yes, though.
We'll do yes on Tuesday.
We're going to, okay.
Yes.
What?
Yes. Tuesday.
Oh, so what you're saying is that we're going to do yes on Tuesday.
That's exactly what I'm saying.
Does that mean that we can't play it today?
Yes.
So yes. So we can go with yes then, right?
Tuesday.
Tuesday, yes? That's yes. Not the, was it Till Tuesday? Because that's a whole different band and a whole different genre. And voices carry. Oh, well, okay. James just gave us the finger.
Yeah, he did. Does that mean we have 1 minute? Or
I think that means we have 1 minute left.
Right.
I hope that means we have 1 minute left.
So do you have any final thoughts in your ADD or ADHD?
I know that I found something very special for you because you're such a huge Carol Burnett fan.
What?
Well.
I am a huge Carol Burnett fan.
I know huge. You are. So let's go ahead and just say it's been a great time. And let me hit a button over here.
It's Carol. No, you don't. Nobody out there in TV land or radio land.
This is radio. Well, I'm not.
Nobody out there in radio land wants to hear me sing. I promise you. Those who can't sing,
well, hey,
push the pencils in the background.
Are we gonna be doing this on Tuesday? Tuesday.
We're actually gonna do this every Tuesday and every Thursday.
Forever.
From 8 to 9 p.m. on KLIV.
During nighttime commute. I like that. So this is 8 to 9 p.m. commute hour with Reed and Ruth. We'd like to take this opportunity to say thank you for having been here. That's funny, isn't it?
Sure.
No. All right. Say, let's go ahead and wrap. So,
okay. Is that a show? Are we done yet? Are we done here?
I think we're done. All right. We'll be back. This is what we got coming up. We got more nonsense from Natalie. Who's changing every time she does a segment? She changes the name of her show, of her segment.
That's so Natalie.
That is Natalie for you. It's coming up on Tuesday, and then we've got Greg with more fantastic movies. And I know nothing controversial to get bleeped. And David Watts hits it out of the park with another home run. And Javier is gonna. I'm not even gonna go there. Anyway, he's got a really fantastic thing coming up that he's gonna be doing as well. Oh, and we have an interview. Don't forget, we have an interview with what's-his-face, Aaron Leatherman from Bioneers is going to be here speaking with us, and I've got his interview, and we're going to be talking to him on Tuesday.
Far out.
It is. So on 3, 2, 1. Good night, San Jose.
Good night.